5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
When I had come down this hill, I had seen this creature cross the road. It would have ripped my locked door from my truck, extracted me from my vehicle, and there wouldn't have been a damn thing I could have done about it.
This thing, I got to notice in its eyes. Its eyes was real, real evil, real sinister looking. You know, the look it was giving me.
Hello?
Get somebody out here.
What's going on now, sir?
That son of a bitch is about 6'9", I don't know.
Do you see him now, sir?
Yes, I'm looking right at him.
Uh-oh.
Welcome to Sasquatch Chronicles, a place where people share their encounters. Let's start the show. Welcome to the show, everyone. If you get a chance, please visit us at sasquatchchronicles.com. You'll find additional shows, additional content up there at the site. So if you get a chance, please go on there, check us out. Again, it's sasquatchchronicles.com. I know on Monday night, Shannon has her show tomorrow night. On Tuesday, we're going to be doing a show where we'll be inviting two different guests on, Tom and Chris, to talk about their encounters with Sasquatch. So look for that up on the site. Tonight's going to be an interesting night. We're going to talk with Alex, and Alex has had a couple encounters with Sasquatch. He was with an expedition company out there in Oregon, and that was the first time he had ever come across one of these things. So I want to welcome Alex to the show.
So tell me about the very first encounter that you had. You were with this expedition company. Sounds like they took you under their wing and brought you along in the beginning with them.
Well, I was the director's son's, you know, best pal. So we tagged along, and they had a huge amount of trust in us. They took us on some pretty intense experiences, and they just said, you either deal with this or you don't, you know?
Yeah.
And, if you start to feel like you're out of your element, you know, let us, but we toughened up pretty quick. We started doing that about age 9, and I did it. I hung out with that crowd for a couple of years. Then I started doing my own stuff with my big brother. But
where did the first experience happen, and kind of walk me through what happened?
Well, the Forest Service maintains a series of shelters throughout the Western Cascades, and they're just primitive shacks, really, where they're just kind of put out there for people to use. They're three-walled sheds, basically, with an open side that faces the fire pit, and inside they have these big wide decks that are, you know, you can use for a table, or you can sleep on them. They're kind of like these built-in bunks. This one, I do recall the name of it, and I actually found it on the map again. Is really in a very remote place. You have to hike into it. We were with about four other, the director and three guides that were being developed and checking out this area. We packed all of our equipment in, set up camp, and then they cut us boys loose. And we also had a tradition where we'd grab these walking sticks and sharpen them into spears. And, you know, we were just cut loose. So this friend of mine and I walked up this valley, heavily vegetated, a lot of salmon berry, about a mile. And it was kind of just a swath of area where the big timber wasn't growing. It was just undergrowth, so there must have been a lot of water there. We came across this meadow, and we noticed these big drag marks, you know, a bunch of drag marks and straight lines that where the grass was torn up down to the dirt. We saw these logs piled up kind of in a rough, very rough teepee kind of a shelter where they were just stacked up, kind of an apex structure. And we knew that was strange. We're like, there's some pretty strong men up here. This, you know, to drag these big logs. They're about a foot in diameter. They're big. We knew that it was not natural. We knew that it was very strange. It just didn't make sense to us. We were discussing, what should we do? Should we go check it out or should we go get your dad? And we started to walk back and we said, you know what? Let's go check it out. We just have to check it out. My buddy was pretty brave. I stayed about 20 yards away, and he approached her real quietly and actually climbed up on one of the logs and shimmied up to the top of it, where all these, you know, the apex point of this thing was. And he was looking down at it, and he was looking at something intently for a couple of minutes. And I knew there was something worth checking out for him to hang out like that. And, suddenly he just stood up, threw his stick in the air, ran down the log, and he just had this pure fright on his face, and he just said, run, 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 and he just ran past me, went right through the bushes to the trail, and we sprinted all the way back to camp, and he just ran up to his dad and grabbed him in a hug and was just sobbing and shaking, and I came running behind him, and they were like, what happened? What's going on? Are you guys okay? What's going on? His son was just sobbing. They couldn't control him. He was shaking. And they took me off to the side. I was like, what's going on here? You know, what'd you guys get into? And I said, I don't know. We found this structure that had been built by something. It wasn't a very good structure. I mean, a man would have done a better job with this thing, but it was just kind of piled up. And it was pretty fresh. There were drag marks, big logs. It was starting to get dark at that point. Beautiful weather in the summertime. And they finally calmed this kid down after about 15 minutes. He finally controlled his breathing and his nerves. And he explained what he had seen. He said he kind of shimmied up on all fours on this log. And he looked down inside. He said there was... He thought it was a bear. Then he realized it was holding a stick and it was digging out the sides, the dirt around the sides of the structure. He was using a stick and he was watching it and he could smell it. It just smelled like animal. And, he could hear it breathing. He could hear it humping and kind of puffing. It was working. And so he decided to whistle at it. And he said the thing stood up, spun 180 degrees as it stood up, and was literally face to face with him, like a foot away. And he said he just absolutely just, he said he's never had anything that terrifying happen to him. So they're eye to eye, and he said the thing opened its mouth a little bit and started to kind of exhale with a little bit of like a throat sound with it. And he just freaked. He said, it stood up like a man. It wasn't a bear. It didn't have a snoot. We know bears. And it looked him in the eye. And he was, you know, he fled. And for good reason.
How old were you guys, Alex? How old were you guys
at that point? We were 10 or 11 years old at that point. But we've been doing this for quite a while with this group. You know, I was raised in this environment.
Well, I'm kind of curious. When it stood up, was it about his size? Is that what he was saying, or was it bigger, much bigger than him?
He was on top of the structure, looking down at it. So he was 7-8 feet in the air, and he was kind of crouched down, looking down into it. And it stood up and looked right into his face.
Oh, wow.
And he said it opened its mouth, and it, he said he could smell its breath. He, it started to exhale on him. They were right face to face, and it freaked him out. I've tried to talk to him, you know, 20 years later, I brought it up with him, and he said, don't even go there, dude. I've had dreams the rest of my life about this.
Did he describe what it looked like at all, or was he too upset at the time?
We didn't know about Sasquatch at that time. It wasn't, you know, really something that had ever been described to us. He said it was just hairy, of course, brown. He said there was no snoot like a bear, no ears like a bear, and the eyes were different. Bears have beady little black eyes, kind of right. like little skunk eyes.
Yeah.
And this thing had eyes, and it looked at him, and he said it actually it made an expression, kind of like, and it started to kind of breathe out like it was about to like scream at him or something or bite him or something. He said his mouth slowly opened, and he knew that he was in serious trouble. So we got back. They calmed him down. Asked him what happened. We were supposed to be there for 3 nights, or 2 nights and 3 days. And the director, this ex-Green Beret, always took a rifle along in one of those padded army cases everywhere we went. Idaho, river rafting trips, everywhere. He always had that rifle. And so the grown-ups kind of took off to the side, and they discussed everything. And they said, well, we're gonna stay the night. And we're just going to hope for the best here. We don't want to leave. We spent hours getting here. So my buddy actually ended up sleeping on the ground under his dad's bunk. He was so terrified. And he wouldn't come out. He wouldn't come out after that. I mean, after he went to bed, you know, there was no horsing around. He didn't join people around the fire. He was in there. He was terrified, and he was messed up.
Yeah, you know, I don't blame him.
Yeah, so it got late. We went to sleep because we were tired. We'd done a lot of work that day, and these guides, they tend to be crack of dawn guys. You know, as soon as the sun's up, you know, it's time to move. And these guys woke us up before dawn, shortly before dawn. It was just, the sky was just starting to get a little blue in it. And they said, boys, wake up. We're leaving now. We got to go. I said, okay, yeah, we're happy to leave. And but we noticed that for once, actually, in all these years, he had his rifle out of the case. And we were hiking back to the van. Got all loaded up in the van. We were driving away, and his dad turned around to the back of us and said, guys, listen, something was walking around our camp last night. Something very big. It was going around and round and round all night. And he said, I've been up all night. So we're going to go back to the base camp at Foley Ridge, and I'm going to get some sleep and talk to some people there about this. And that was it. That's what happened. He was, you know, we weren't so cavalier about just running amok in the woods after that. He was very cautious. It took him about a week to kind of settle down. And the guys who built these, so this base camp, they had a ropes course where they limb and they top these big trees, and they make these kind of these rope courses, like these military rope courses. Kind of like an Ewok village. They have all these nets and tight ropes with handholds, and you know, it's guide training. And the guys they had build that with these two Indian loggers who built out this course for him. One of the Indian guys came up to Brad later on and said, tell me exactly what you saw, because everyone's talking about this. And Brad told him, and he said, yeah, I've seen those my entire life. I came across a little one one time, and he was almost crying. He was so scared. He said, where I grew up, we could hear their calls at night. We know they're out there. We've always known it. But he said, you're brave. You know, you're brave, and you're smart to run away.
That's interesting that he one of the guides came forward, and that's just interesting that he came forward and said, hey, tell me what you saw. And he came across a little one. He said a little one was crying.
Yeah, he said when he was younger in the logging days, that would probably place him back in the 50s or early 50s maybe, because they're older guys. He said, yeah, he came across a little one. It kind of curled up like it thought it was doomed, and then he got closer to it, and the thing just jumped up and ran off. And he said it was a child, definitely a child Sasquatch. And he said they're cute when they're babies, but he said, you know, they're when they get big, they're not cute anymore. And so I've always learned, you know, ever since this whole thing came into my thinking, I've always known these things are not warm, fuzzy, hairy, and the Hendersons. You know, these are wild animals, and you know, I have a lot of respect for wild animals. They have bad days too. You know, they have bad days when they feel threatened. They manifest it. They let you know. They don't want you in the area. They let you know. They don't like your smell. They let you know. And they really don't like dogs. That's what I learned. So fast forward about five or six years when I had my driver's license. Our family had an interest in a big ranch out in Central Oregon and Bend, Oregon. So I used to drive back and forth between Eugene and Bend. And there's an old Highway 242, and it's only a seasonal highway. And they built it on top of the old stage line between the two towns. And in the wintertime, they don't plow it. They have these big orange gates. They swing down, and you know, you can drive up as far as those gates, and then you just see just a wall of snow, you know, end of road. So I had another buddy back in my teens. We were pretty avid climbers, and we used to do a lot of what's called peak bagging. We just go and we climbed all the Cascades several times, almost all the different routes available. You know, that's how we spent our time. We didn't go to parties. You know, we were real outdoorsy, and we were just really on fire with this stuff. We were constantly planning our next trip in high school, and then as soon as school got out of you know, 2 o'clock on Friday, we go home and get our gear, then get on the road, go do this stuff. But we got into our heads one time. This is in May of 1980, to be the first ones to enter our names in the summit logbook for that year. I don't know. It seemed important to us at the time. We thought it was cool. So we left early. It was a heavy snow year. So we left and went up that 242 up as far as they had, you know, plowed to, and then we came to the wall of snow, and we parked the car, left it right there, climbed up on the snow, and put on our packs and our mountaineering skis, which are basically cross-country skis with a, you know, pivoting heel, and you can go over the snow pretty efficiently that way. To climb Middle Sister, you know, we had a long approach now since the road was closed for the most part. So we started off, you know, about sundown. Friday night. No, actually, it was on Saturday night, I think it was. Started going up, and, you know, it was a clear night, big moon. And there's a series of switchbacks that gets you up to this high plateau where the, you know, the base of these three sisters. And it took us hours. You know, we were slogging up this road. It was miles. It was late in the snow season, so there have been some freeze-thaw cycles, so the surface crust was developing where, you know, you had like a half inch of pretty good ice on top, then you'd fall through into this duff down below. So it was hard going, and we were well into the night, 2-3 in the morning, starting to get up to the high altitude to get off the road and then start going overland through the woods, then up the timberline, then up onto the glaciers to the summit. And so we're on the high plateau, and off to our right rear out of the valley, and I know that there's a lake back there, a bunch of little ponds, and there's actually a bunch of creek systems. We heard these screaming howls, roars, and real far away. They're echoing, getting to us, you know, by echoes at first. You know, after a few minutes, we heard them more and more, and they seemed to be getting closer. And at that point, I said something. I was like, "What do you think that is?" And my buddy's just like, "I'm not sure. I want to know. Probably a cougar. Let's keep going. Let's pick up the pace here and try to get in front of it. And maybe it'll, you know, maybe it's not, doesn't know we're here, and it's there's two getting into a fight or something." We kept on going, huffing and puffing, and it was getting closer. It was definitely getting closer, and we stopped. We said, "Look, whatever that is, it dialed in on us. It's screaming at us. And I think it's one. I don't think we have to be careful because there's echoes in that canyon. But we were pretty sure it was one." And we kept going, picked up the pace big time. We were really trying to get away from this thing going forward. And, it was real close. At that point, we could hear it 100 feet away. We could hear it, its footsteps popping through the crusty snow. It was pretty loud. And the footfalls were, you know, two-legged. And, you know, scrunch, 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 scrunch. We could hear it. And it was getting closer and closer. And we were just like, "Oh man, it's here. Dude, it's here. What are we going to do?" So it's just keep going, you know. We were skiing as fast as we could. I guess the DOT or somebody, whoever maintains that road in the summertime, they left a grading machine up there that was all packed in snow except for the little glass operator's cockpit sticking up. It's a glass box really sticking up. And it was getting too close, and it was keeping up. You could hear it run ahead a little bit, then it would kind of come back, and it was running around in the tree line, and it's all big timber. It's all hemlock and Doug fir at that climate zone. It was real close. At one point we stopped, we could hear it breathing. It was breathing hard. We could hear these kind of this real low guttural, kind of like a throat growl. Kind of just a really horrible, but it was big. What really sticks in my mind is the power of its screams and the volume. It would just shake your insides. It was just absolutely just, we were freaked out. So we decided to, well, we can't outrun this thing. What are we going to do? Then that's the point where it started to tear some branches off of trees. Now, I've always thought back that if it was the summertime, it probably would have started chucking rocks at us. But it was all snowing, there's no rocks to be had, and it tore a couple branches down off of a tree, and they weren't small branches. It was like big, you know, crack, crack, snap, you know, it was just big branches. And it was beating on a tree with one. And it was hitting it hard, and we actually saw some splinters come out of the tree line and, you know, slide toward us. And we were just like, "Oh my God, what is going to happen here?" And we said, we have to get defensive here. We have to do something. Let's break into that grading machine. So we broke into that, you know, kicked in a window, and we were both sitting back to back in that glass box. We had nothing but like ski poles and Swiss Army knives. That's all we had. You know, it was pathetic.
Jesus.
And this thing was, we could hear it moving around and screaming, making these really strange, throat sounds, like a low kind of gurgling, guttural growl with some kind of like almost like a whimpering, almost like a frustrated whimper. And it was really odd. It was, we didn't know what to think. And then we were there for hours just shaking. We were literally shaking. And then it moved off. We stopped hearing it. And it didn't scream as it left, like it screamed when it approached. It didn't make any sounds when it left. It just kind of left. And it was starting, you know, it was getting 5 o'clock in the morning. We were like, we gotta do something here. We gotta do something. Let's go up and climb Middle Sister, get this thing done. I think it's gone. It's left. So we skied on up to the place where the trailhead is that goes in at a, about a 2 or 3 o'clock diagonal off the road. And we picked that trail because there were creek crossings and they had bridges for this trail. And when you have heavy snowfall, one of the most dangerous things you can do is ski close to a creek because the overhanging snow can break away and you're in the water now. And it's overhung on both sides. You really can't get out. So they're really dangerous. And you don't get near creeks in heavy snow in the wintertime. And we went up this trail. We got to the bridge and we looked over and we saw these tracks about 40 feet to the right. Walked down to the creek and it simply just walked down through the snow across the creek and there are two big, steps coming up out of it and the snow was all disturbed around it and it just went right through that like it wasn't anything. Just like there was no sense of danger when it did that. It just walked across the creek like it does it every day. And we skied over and licked the tracks. And they're beautiful tracks. They were beautiful toe prints. You could see where it had dragged its toes between the steps on the surface of the snow. You could see everything. It was really, and they were big. I'm going to say, 17, 18 inches. And they were deep. They were punching down about 2 feet into the snow. Whereas our feet, were only going about 6 inches into the snow. It was big and it was heavy. And we were like, where do you think it's going? It's almost like it's kind of, we couldn't tell if the tracks were minutes old or hours old.
Let me ask you, on the tracks, how far apart were each step looking back, Jimmer?
They were 5 or 6 feet. They were huge. Wow. They were absolutely, it was marching through the woods just like nothing. And it ran around. It wasn't daunted by these conditions at all. I mean, it was clear out. It was late snow. It probably wasn't going to snow anymore that year. But so they veered off to the right, to our perpendicular, to the right. We thought, well, that's a good sign. We kept on going. We got above tree line. We started to make these zigzag traverses to stay high in the ridge lines because you want to stay up the glaciers when there's that much snow because you can't tell if there's a crevasse underneath it or not. You stay up where the ridges are, and that's where the rock is. And that was the weekend that Mount St. Helens went. We got up over the ridge. We heard two booms. About a half hour later, we got up over the ridge, and we looked to the north, and we could see St. Helens. And that part is actually just as weird as all the rest, that we saw St. Helens shortly after it went off, and it was the end of the world.
I can imagine that's how you felt.
We both just said, you know what? I've seen enough. I've seen enough of everything. Let's go.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
We're going to blame this. We just turned our skis downhill. We had we were avid skiers. We skied like madmen to get out of there. We stopped and looked at the tracks there by the bridge again. And, we're just shaking our heads, like, "What the hell is going? Is this real?" And then we skied on down, but we got down to the machine where we broke into, and this time we had daylight. We started looking around, and the thing had been walking around all over the woods. There were tracks everywhere. There's still only one, I think. We were just like, "What happened? What just happened last night?" So we skied on down to the car. We got in the car. And we're usually pretty talkative guys with each other because we're best friends. But I remember it was a very quiet trip home. And about halfway home, my buddy just said, "Man, that was real. That whatever that was, we didn't imagine that. What do we do? Can we talk to somebody? Should we talk to the Rangers? Should we talk to your dad because he's a biology professor? Who should we talk to?" And I said, "I don't know, man. I don't know, but I think we're lucky that we came out of that." And so we pulled up to my house. My dad came out on the came out on the front porch and said, you know, he had a little frantic look on his face. He said, I'm glad to see you boys, because St. Helens is going off right now, and Portland is under ash, and there's all kinds of problems. I-5's shut down. People are dying, and I'm glad you guys are back. And that, so the conversation's kind of, the tension was based on St. Helens and the, you know, and the effects of that. I didn't tell my dad for about 2 weeks.
I'm kind of curious what your dad had to say about it.
He just kind of listened politely and shook his head and said, yeah, all right, well, I'm glad you guys are okay. And I said, Dad, you know, listen, we saw these tracks, and I'll draw some for you. And you know, I'll draw them, you know, in real scale on a piece of paper. And he said, no, you don't need to do that. I never really learned if he was being polite. He's a pretty rigorous scientist. He needs, you know, he doesn't really look at something unless there's, you know, physical evidence. But I said, Dad, there is physical evidence. He tracks. He said, you don't know if there are snowshoers. I'm like, these weren't snowshoe tracks, Dad. I know snowshoe tracks are snowshoe tracks. These were feet. These had toes. These had heels. They were, and these long strides. It was a big animal. But the thing is, when we, right before we broke into that snow machine, we could see its shape in the tree line. Because when you have a clear night like that, the snow just reflects all the available light, and there is quite a bit of light. And so that was. You know, we saw it. I never saw any features. I never saw any eyes. I didn't see any face. But it was moving around. You could see it moving around, and it was really aggressive. It was really, really aggressive, and it was keyed in on us. And there's no question that it locked onto us a long time before it got close to us. And it was very unhappy that we were there, and it was letting us know that you need to get out of here. We were the first people in that part of the Cascades probably all year. I'm sure of that. There were no other tracks. And that was kind of our whole purpose of this trip, was supposed to be the first ones into the area for the season. And, it was mind boggling. Absolutely mind boggling. I know exactly, I've studied the area pretty closely. I know that there's a lot of water in there. There's a major valley that the 242 goes up. It's just a corridor right down to the Mackenzie River. There's a whole bunch of tributary creeks in that area.
It makes you wonder if there was just one of you guys, if it would have been a different story as opposed to two. Because even though they seem aggressive, it's almost kind of a cautious, I mean, they'll come in on you, and it makes me wonder what would happen if it would have just been yourself out there.
Yeah, that's interesting too, because we didn't have a chance. If this thing really wanted to hurt us, we didn't have a chance. We knew it. We knew we were on the menu. It was absolutely terrifying. And I had bad dreams for years about this. I can still hear its roaring screams. I can still hear it. I know exactly what they sound like. And
yeah, and for people listening, it's hard to grasp that when, you know, someone just saying that, but I've heard what you've heard, and I know exactly what you mean. I mean, you can hear, you can feel it as much as you hear it. I mean, when they blast you with it.
Yeah, and it makes your body tremble. It just shakes you. The sound is such a wall of sound hitting you. And it's intimidating. These things are the king of the forest. I'm
yeah.
You know, they've been the king of forests for a long time. And there's a reason why when you go into really, really remote places where people have not been, and you come across deer and elk, they're naturally timid if you're walking upright. Think about that. They don't know anything about it.
Yeah, that's true.
You know, they're naturally timid for a reason. These things hunt. These things are the apex predators. And I'm sure I'm sure grizzlies stand down to them. I'm sure they do. These things are, the size of the one I saw was utterly huge. And we were freaked. You know, we were freaked. We changed after that. We were really cautious. We always questioned, you know, is what we're about to do really smart, you know? I mean, we're going into some remote areas like north of Mount Jefferson. To the west of Jefferson, there's not a whole lot of access. I mean, to climb Mount Jefferson, the closest you can get with a vehicle is 16 miles, and that's a four-wheel drive vehicle. And it's not like the Three Sisters, but there's a whole ton of trails. They're out there. And this is, you know, this is what I like about your show, Wes, is that people are speaking about these things for what they are. These are wild animals that have tempers like other animals. They feel threatened and they push back. They know they rule the night. You know, these are not warm, fuzzy creatures that you want to walk out in the woods with a bag of apples with. You know, you're not going to shake hands with one of these things.
Yeah, you're not. And that's what most people, I mean, I think people who've had legitimate encounters, I think, realize really quick that that's just not going to happen. I think a lot of people who have it in their mind that they're friends with them and they run around on their property, and it's just not reality with these things. I mean, they like you said, they have short tempers. You know, they're really quick to confront you, like you found out. I mean, they're not going to run from a fight. They're going to come and bring it to you. You know, like you said, being on the menu, I get that. I completely get what you're saying.
I think the subject is going to be blown wide open here sooner than later. I think it's about to happen. I hate to say it, but there's no good outcome for anybody involved. It's gonna get weird. No one's, you know, whoever does this, you know, whoever brings in a chunk of a specimen or whatever, their lives are not going to go well thereafter. They're going to be hounded and dogged. And this is what I, you know, kind of want to have a private talk with you about, Wes, is that, you know, we got to talk about this because I don't want this to ruin my life. Yeah. And, at the same time, you know, I haven't really talked to people about this, and this is kind of a big deal to me. And when I, in recollecting what happened, it's kind of bringing up this deep, deep upwelling of stuff that was really hard to put away. I spent years trying to put this away and get it out of my system, and you don't, you know, you don't.
Yeah, it never goes away. It really doesn't.
No, and it changes you. And I feel bad, you know, every time I read about somebody who, you know, like John Bissell in Oregon. He went on a 2-week fishing trip, you know, and he put in, you know, his trailhead he used was right there at, was it Shale Rock campground or something, and a month before, you know, campers were ran out of there by an aggressive encounter. They were ran out, including the ranger. They were, yeah, ran out of, and then a month later, John Bissell decides to go into that area, right into his backyard, and go in there solo for 2 weeks, and now he's gone. He's gone. Not a trace.
Yeah.
And there are a lot of caves up there. I know these lava tubes. There's a lot of caves up there. There are some hot springs. My dad is actually a hot spring specialist. He's a thermophilic microbiologist. And he had access to the first Landsat images back in the 60s that showed hot spots. And he would get access to those. And that was how I grew up quite a bit, was chasing down these, you know, these unknown hot springs all over the Cascades. There's a bunch of them. And he'd go up there and he'd take his samples and these little, he had his kit with him, and we'd go, you know, we didn't use trails. We used map and compass and did dead reckoning and overland travel.
I think as this comes out, I think it's going to come out, like you said, it's eventually going to come out. Whether, you know, someone's going to end up bringing one in regardless. And you're right. I don't think that it's a lot easier said than done, but I think a lot of things will change. You know, I've talked to state biologists in Washington and in Oregon. that are told not to go into areas alone. And they are, you know, they're told all kinds of reasons. Well, there's a rogue bear in the area. Well, we have black bear. I mean, for the most part, a black bear will run from you. I don't think I've ever had an aggressive black bear encounter. I'm not saying that doesn't happen, but for the most part, a black bear, as soon as they see in the area or they get a whiff of you or anything, they're gone. They'll take off. Then the story will change and they're told, well, there's a crazy person out there. And, you know, just a lot of, you know, I think the public's ready for this to come out and say, hey, there's these wild animals out there. They, you know, can be aggressive and can be very dangerous. And so here's what you can do and here's what not to do. And if you come across one that's, you know, and just kind of tell the public what to do when they come across it. I don't think there has to be so much, you know, obviously it's going to come out that it's a most likely a primate, which creates problems. But I think for the most part, the public's ready for this to come out. I think for the most part, most people realize this thing's out there. Most people realize this is going on in the national forest. This is going on in our forest. You know, it's going to come out eventually. It's in when it does, all the crazy stories about the telepathy and the cloaking. And I think a lot of those people are going to almost be embarrassed for saying, you know, they're going to, it's going to be, you know, it's going to come out that it's nothing more than a wild animal, dangerous wild animal out there. And I think a lot of people are going to probably not only eat crow, but if you were told, you and your friend before skiing in that area, hey, you know, there's Sasquatch in this area. They're known to be aggressive. Be careful when you go in this area. You probably would have looked at it a little bit differently when you were there.
Yeah. Yeah. It was, you know, it was something that we did routinely up in the woods. We never even thought about this. We rarely even thought about bears because my dad is one of the main, biologists in Yellowstone too. And I've been around bears, and bears are actually, and my dad told me, he said, bears brains and behaviors are a lot like a dog. It's like, they're like naughty dogs that get off, that chew through their rope. They roam the neighborhood, knocking over trash cans. He's like, they're just like that. They just want to, they're just pigs. They're one dimensional. And he said, you know, don't back down. Just make yourself big and loud. But he says, you know, when you go into Yellowstone Park, they hand you a pamphlet about what to do if you come across a bear. And he said, that's just the dumbest thing, what they actually tell people to do to play dead. You know, walking away quietly is the best thing to do. But he said, what he does is he takes along a pot, two pots, you know, for camping pots. He said, if he comes across the bear, he starts banging them together because they don't hear that. They don't hear metallic sounds in the wild, and they hate that sound. It really just unnerves them, and they want to get away from that. But he said at night, the best thing to do is to pop a road flare and wave it around. So they've never seen that kind of bright pink light before at night, and they don't know what to think about it. So they move off. They're cautious. But he said, you know, it's the hissing sound that it makes too that freaks them out. And he's just little things like that. He said if they just tell people that, you know, it'd be way easier. And playing dead, you know, and it's the whole finding Bigfoot, the BFRO crew is, you know, the message is wrong, you know, and putting the subject of this species out as abject entertainment for the masses is just wrong. Now you have kids, now you have 11-year-old, now you have, you know, 12-year-old kids going out looking for these things, the dumbest thing in the world, and they're going out there and they're whooping, tree knocking. It's like, no, you don't do that. You don't, when you're in the wilderness, you always mitigate your risk.
And that's the thing with these things. A lot of people, you know, they, you know, treat these things like the gentle forest giants. And like yourself, I mean, anyone who's had a legitimate encounter, that's just not the case. It's just, it's not reality. Will these things up and leave the area when you're there most of the time? Yeah, I would say a lot of times they do, but, you know, they're very short tempers and they're very territorial. A lot of times they won't just get up and leave. A lot of times they'll make you leave. And then there's confrontations, you know, like you mentioned with the fishermen who just went up and missing. If people knew how many people just vanish out there in the woods, I think people would be shocked. that just up and vanish. Now you can, like, you can put a portion of those people that maybe the elements got them, maybe other wild animals got them. But even in those situations, you don't just vanish. There's always some sort of, well, he fell into the river, or, you know, there's always something. If you get attacked by a cougar, or most people are going to put up a fight, you know, there's going to be some sort of evidence of them left over. And the amount of people that just vanish, I think people would be shocked. In Oregon, Texas, Washington, that just go missing and completely vanish. And they bring dogs in and they won't track the person. It's astounding. It's astounding how many people just go missing and vanish.
And there's no database. No one maintains a database or anything. They don't even, it doesn't even exist. You know, once you cross that line into the national forest property or the parks or the USF property, you're stepping off the edge of the earth. The only thing, you know, we have these little satellite transponders that are kind of our own little secret thing, and they're small. They clip onto your body, and it's kind of like an e-perb, you know, for an overboard fisherman in Alaska. It doesn't turn off unless you, and they're waterproof. They're really tough. So, you know, people need to at least have those attached to their shoulders, you know, to their arms as an armband. And that way we'll still get a ping. We'll still get a very accurate ping within 5 feet. But, you know, I mean, these technologies exist. I mean, at least tell people, you know, at least the message should be like, listen, there, you are going into harm's way when you go into the wilderness. Here's something you should wear with you all the time. Just for the same reason they tell people who go skiing in the backcountry, wear a transponder, wear an avalanche transponder, because we at least we have a chance to find you. But hikers, they have none of that. They have no warnings whatsoever, and it's just as dangerous, in my opinion, to go into the wilderness without some kind of breadcrumb technology that leads people to you or your body or your or at least remains of your equipment, so people can, you know, look at it and get a sense of what happened to you, you know. But this John Bissell, nothing, absolutely nothing. No polar tech chunks of fleece, no pieces of a sleeping bag, no piece of a snapped fishing rod, nothing.
Alex, I appreciate you coming on the show. Thanks so much. Thank you for sharing everything.
Yeah, you're very welcome. And keep doing a good job, Wes. You guys are great.
Sounds good. questions to me.